It's a real pleasure to be here. So I'm going to be talking about joint work with Tsuyoshi Ito. He used to be a postdoc here at IQC, and recently he moved. He's now a researcher at NEC in Princeton. So I'm going to talk about things that are a little bit more complexity, you know, on the complexity side of things rather than algorithms. So I'll try to take it slow. Feel free to interrupt me with questions. There will be some algorithmic implication at some point, so I'll try to remember not to forget to mention it. So let me start with a little motivating example. I'm going to present this as a game, but it was introduced by Perez and Merman in the 90s, and they were really motivated by the study of Bell inequalities and trying to find simpler variants of the Cohen-Specker theorem. But as a game, it goes like this. So you have two players, Alice and Bob. They're cooperating, trying to win this game. And the game is arbitrated by this computer there, so I'll call him the referee. So the game is parameterized by this square. So the game is really happening on the right-hand side. I'm going to use the left-hand side just as a visual aid. So the game works like this. The referee first picks one of the three columns at random and sends it to Alice. So he's asking Alice to return values for the cells that are in the column, so bit values. So Alice replies those, sends those back, sorry. And then he also picks one of the rows at random, so first, second, or third row, sends that to Bob, and also asks Bob to fill in values for the cells in that row. And what are the constraints? There's three constraints. The first is that whatever Alice replies, her three bits should have odd parity. So this is the case here. Whatever Bob replies, his three bits should have even parity. And the last constraint is that so Alice's column and Bob's row are always going to intersect in one position, right? So in that position, the values that Alice and Bob reply should be the same. They should be consistent in this point of intersection. And there's one, the referee checks these. There's one important constraint on the players in these games. So they're cooperating, they're working together, except that when the game starts, they don't get to talk between each other. So there's no communication allowed. That's what kind of makes it a little bit hard, because Alice knows if she's being asked, you know, the first or second or third row, but she doesn't know what Bob is being asked. So in particular, she doesn't know on which of her three cells this consistency constraint is going to bear. So if you think about this game a little bit, you try to figure out what's the best they can do, what's the best strategy for the players, it's not hard to see that they can't win with probability one. It's impossible to always be successful, and the reason is that it's impossible for Alice to find values for each of her three columns that always satisfy the odd parity constraint. Right, this is the case, this is the case. Here it's the case if I choose one. And also Bob, if Bob is to satisfy the even parity constraints, then they won't be able to be consistent everywhere. Basically, the reason is if you add up Alice's columns, the overall parity should be odd. But if you add up Bob's rows, then the overall parity should be even. So and it can't be odd and even at the same time, so you can't win this game of probability one. So now, why is it interesting? The reason is that if you allow a little bit more power to these players, so now you allow them to be quantum, the game is exactly the same, but I'm giving them the ability to use an entangled state that doesn't let them communicate. But of course, now they can get maybe more correlations. Now they can win the game with probability one. So there's a perfect strategy. It's actually a very simple strategy. I'm not going to describe it, but it's simple. It's just based on using two EPR pairs. Alice and Bob each receive their question. They make a measurement on their halves of the EPR pairs. They get an outcome. They send that back. And it will satisfy all the constraints. It'll always be perfectly, it win the game with probability one. So why is it interesting? So we have this quantum strategy that succeeds with probability one. But we know that it's impossible to consistently assign answers to every possible question, simultaneously assign answers to every possible question that would satisfy all the constraints. Right? So it's impossible. They're impossible to satisfy simultaneously. But this strategy still convinces the referee has success probability one in the game, which is saying that this quantum strategy has some kind of a local flavor. So it's able to answer any pair of questions with probability one, but you can't transform it into an assignment of answers to all possible questions simultaneously. So this is probably familiar to most of you. This is, you know, it's just saying quantum mechanics is non-local. You can phrase this as a violation of a Bell inequality. But what I want to do in this talk is, you know, try to understand what this example is saying in the context of complexity theory. So draw some consequences of that example, and also maybe use tools from complexity theory in order to say something about what's going on here. So what does complexity theory have to do with this? Well, I have to back off a little bit. And basically, at the same time as this problem was investigated in physics, complexity was going through some kind of a revolution that has to do with thinking about proofs. So you're all familiar with NP, right? This is the set of all languages that can be verified using a procedure of the following form. So you have a polynomial time verifier down there. The verifier is given a certain input, and he's asked to verify whether, decide whether the input is in the language or not. So think of the language as being three sat. The input is just a bunch of clauses, a formula. You want to decide whether it's satisfiable or not. And for this, he has access to an infinitely powerful but not necessarily trusted prover. So there's Turing there. So maybe most of you know that this is Turing year this year. So Turing is everywhere, including over there. So the prover can provide you a proof. So in that case, it would be an assignment to the variables in the in your formula, and the verifier checks the proof, decides to accept or reject. So there's two important properties that such a proof system should have. The first is completeness. So if the input is in the language, if the formula is satisfiable, there should be a proof that is accepted by your proof system, a way to convince the verifier that it is satisfiable. And also the soundness, which is that if the input is not in the language, then whatever the prover tells the verifier is going to reject, right? There's no way to convince this verifier, there should be no way to convince this verifier that a unsatisfiable formula actually is. So you can generalize this setting a little bit by adding randomness. So you allow the verifier now to be randomized, a polynomial time, instead of being deterministic. In that case, we relax the completeness and soundness conditions a little bit. So instead of saying that there is a proof that should be accepted, we say that there is a proof that should be accepted with high probability, say 90%. This 90% is kind of arbitrary. In the soundness case, we say that no proof should be accepted with probability more than 0.1. Right? So whatever the proof, it should be rejected with high probability. OK, so that's straightforward. Let's do something more interesting. Now we have this prover. He's giving us a proof. Why don't we go a little bit further and start interacting? What if we allow the verifier to ask questions to the prover, have an interaction, maybe ask for clarifications about that proof? What happens now? Well, we get a more general complexity class called IP for interactive proof. And it turns out that it's a bigger class. So it was characterized in the 90s, and it's known that IP is equal to P space. So you get something bigger just by letting the verifier interact with the prover. Now, what else can we do? We've extracted as much as we could from Turing, so let's maybe have one more person. So there's Michael Benor there. He's one of the authors who introduced this model. Let's do the same thing, but now we get to ask questions to two different provers instead of one prover. So what's the point of having two provers? Well, I'll try to give you an idea of that in the next slide, but the most important restriction, of course, is that, again, they don't talk to each other, right? If they could talk to each other, they would really just be the same thing as one prover, because these provers are infinitely powerful. So twice infinitely powerful is once infinitely. It's the same as just one. But the point is that we're putting restrictions on them by enforcing no communication. I'll show you how this is used, give you some idea in the next slide. But then you get a class which is called MIP, Multiprover Interactive Proofs. And the big result of the 90s by Babai, Fortnow, and Lund was you get a much bigger class. So suddenly, because you're allowed to talk to two provers instead of one, you have much more power in deciding languages. You get NEXP. So we went from NP to NEXP, non-deterministic exponential time. So these provers adding interaction, adding two provers, is something that's very useful in complexity theoretic terms. And this has been used. So these results, and more importantly, the techniques that are used to prove these results, have had a very big influence on complexity theory. So they led to PCP theorem. Maybe some of you are familiar with that, and also lots of results in hardness of approximation. So before I move on, let me just give you a brief idea of how we can use two provers. So just a simple example. Suppose that you're given a system of linear equations, and you want to decide, well, not necessarily if it has a perfect solution, but say you want to decide whether there's an assignment to the variables that satisfies, you know, most equations or at most 51% of the equations. So you're given the promise that one of these two hold, and you want to decide which. So you could try to figure it out by yourself, right? Just try every possible assignment, but that's going to take a while if there's a lot of equations. Another thing you can do is that if you have access to a prover, you can just ask that prover for the best possible assignment to the variables. So the prover is there. He's just going to tell him what he thinks is the best assignment. He can figure that out. And then you'll just check, right? So that's easier than doing it yourself. It's helpful. What about two provers? Well, you can do something even simpler. So here's a protocol. What you'll do is that you'll just pick one of these equations at random and take the variables from that equation. So I chose the second there and send them to the first prover. and ask him for what are the values for these variables in the best possible assignment to the equations, and he'll tell you something. And of course, if you stop there, you have a problem, because that prover knows that you're interested in that equation, and whatever the other equations are, he can always convince you that that equation should be satisfiable. Right? He can always find an assignment just to that equation that satisfies just that equation. So that wouldn't work by itself, and this is why we're using the second prover. What we'll do is that, who can't talk, we'll pick just one of the three variables now, say x6 at random, and send it to the second prover and ask him for what is the value for x6 in the best assignment. And he'll say, well, something. And then we'll check. We'll check that these guys give the same answer to the sixth variable. And this enforces, just because each of them doesn't know the question that the other is being asked, it forces them to be consistent throughout the whole protocol. Now, this first prover cannot, you know, strictly give me answers that depend on the fact that this was the equation I was asking him, because if he does, then the second prover is likely not to be consistent with him, because the second prover doesn't know which equation was selected for the first prover. Right, so that's just a vague idea. Of course, there's many more complicated tricks that you can play, but usually this is how the two provers are asked. We're using them to check once one against the other, just to make sure that they can't convince us of something that should be wrong, that in the case that we should reject. So let's go back to the previous picture, and let's move to the quantum setting now. So what can we do? Maybe the most natural thing that you want to do if you think about quantum computing is, you know, there was all these interaction, all these messages, let's just make these messages quantum, right? Have quantum communication. So now we're a quantum polynomial time verifier, just BQP, again trying to check if some input is in the language, and he gets his proof. So that's Kitaev there, who introduced the corresponding class called QMA. So it's really an analog of the classical MA, but now you get a quantum proof. So presumably that's more powerful. So you could get something a little bit bigger because you get quantum information from that prover. So now we can look at IP. Sorry, John. But John Waters introduced the analog for IP. It's called QIP. So it's really the same. You are allowed to have interaction, but now these messages should be quantum. And they're known to be equal. So in terms of complexity classes, QIP equals IP. This is a very nice result from 2 or 3 years ago by Ji, Zhang, Upadhyay, and Waterloo. So allowing quantum communication doesn't change the expressive power of the class. There's still some nice things you can do. For instance, using quantum messages, you can reduce the number of rounds of interaction that are necessary to only 3. Whereas if you only have classical messages, it's not known that you could do such a thing. Finally, we can do the same modification for MIP. This was done by Kobayashi and Matsumoto, and they introduced QMIP, which is just you have two provers, but now they're quantum, no communication, and you can exchange quantum messages. And they showed that, again, you get the same thing. It doesn't really help in absolute terms. MIP is equal to QMIP. So that's fairly well understood. But what we're interested in here is a different modification that you can make, is saying, well, these provers are quantum now, right? So if they're quantum, then they could share entanglement. Why not? I don't really have any way of preventing that. And it doesn't change my basic assumption that there should be no communication between the provers. I'm just saying they can use entanglement. I can't prevent it. It won't allow them to communicate. So you can introduce the corresponding complexity classes. So they're called MIP star and QMIP star. So a little bit of notation here. I don't know if you know this, but the Q is always for quantum messages. And now the star is for entanglement. So for instance, this has classical communication. This guy is classical. But the star refers to the fact that the provers may be quantum and may share entanglement. This one has quantum messages and entanglement. So you can look at the two of them. You can introduce these two classes. They were also introduced by Kobayashi and Matsumoto. And now it becomes kind of interesting because really two different things can happen because of introducing entanglement. So the first thing that can happen, and this is sort of pointed towards by this magic square example I gave you, is that because of their entanglement, they're allowed more strategies, right? There's more possibilities for collusion. They can potentially have a higher success probability, and this could let them cheat in ways that they couldn't without their entanglement. So it could be that some protocols that were here, that were sound, that let you decide NX languages, now they're no longer sound. You can cheat using your entanglement, which means that the class could become lower. It could go all the way down to QIP. That's the main thing you're worried about, you know, these provers using an entanglement in order to increase their odds of winning in the game when they shouldn't. But the other thing could also happen. Potentially, you could have a bigger class. And the reason is that, well, this verifier there knows that the provers are using entanglement, of course, so maybe he can use that to his advantage. Maybe we can design new protocols that were sort of, you know, irrelevant or not interesting if the provers don't have entanglement, but now they become interesting protocols, and they let us decide bigger languages. So two possibilities are open or possible. Let me tell you a little bit more about what's known about them. So again, just this MIP, multi-prover interactive proofs, with or without quantum messages, we know this is exactly equal to non-deterministic exponential time. And the question is, what happens when you throw in entanglement in this picture? So one thing that we do know is that if you restrict the power of the verifier, so you don't consider like the most general kind of proof systems, then it's possible the first option that I showed you on the previous slide can happen. So the class can become much smaller. There's at least two instances where this happens. The first is this class parity MIP. So it's like MIP, but you have a bunch of restrictions. For instance, there's only two provers, no more. And also the amount of information you can get from the provers is just one bit from either of them. And also the only thing you get to see as a verifier is the parity. So you only just get one bit total, which is the parity of the two bits from the provers. That's a big restriction, but in the classical setting, classical provers, it's actually not. So even if you restrict the format of the proof system like this, you still get capture the whole of NXP. So you still can do an impressive amount of things in that restricted class. But what Cleave, Oyetoner, and Waters showed is that the same class, but you give entanglement to the provers, then it collapses. You can do much less. It goes all the way down to EXP, even p-space. That's a consequence of further work by Vinner. And the reason they're able to show that is that they give an algorithm. So they say, well, give me your protocol, give me a description of this verifier, and they give an algorithm that's based on semi-definite programming that figures out exactly what is the maximum success probability of entangled provers in the protocol. So if that algorithm can decide what's the maximum success probability, of course it can make the difference between the maximum being close to 1 or close to 0, meaning that algorithm can actually decide the language that this protocol was supposed to decide. And if it turns out in that case it's an algorithm that runs in exponential time, so it shows that the corresponding complexity class should be included in EXP. There's another slightly more general setting in which this happens. It's a result by Kempe, Regev, and Toner. And they show that a similar phenomenon happens, but I don't want to get into it too much, for proof systems that have a kind of a unique property. So they're a bit more general. You allow a little bit more. But still, as soon as the provers get entanglement, the complexity class collapses. Suddenly you have an algorithm when you didn't before. Sorry, and one last case where there's a collapse is now you consider general proof systems, no restriction on the verifier, but you make the provers even more powerful. So we went from, you know, classical provers to provers using entanglement, and now we allow even more provers that apply arbitrary no-signaling strategies. I'm not really defining what this is, but it's even more power than entanglement, but still no communication. In that case, Ito showed that the corresponding class again collapses to EXP. So we have all these collapses, either if we put restrictions on the power of the verifier or if we increase the power of the provers. What about the general case? Well, in general case, we really don't know much. There's one small thing that we know, which is a result of mine and Kobayashi, Matsumoto, Toner, Kempe, and also of Ito, Kobayashi, and Matsumoto, which is that if you allow general protocols, there is a way to avoid kind of the magic square curse. So in the sense that if you start from a protocol such that if the provers don't use any entanglement, they cannot win with probability 1, then you can change it into a setting where even if you give them entanglement, still they cannot win with probability 1, right? Which is something that happened in the magic square. So we can, this is what I call perfect cheating. If the non-entangled provers couldn't win with probability 1, then also entanglement doesn't let you with probability 1. But the actual parameters, the way this is proved, that they're a bit too weak, it doesn't really imply any kind of consequence in terms of complexity classes. And maybe one thing that points to why these questions are a bit hard is that, so in terms of upper bounds, you know, how big is this class? This is the second thing I showed you on the previous slide. We don't have any. We don't know. This could be really big for all that we know. And one of the reasons is that we don't know how much entanglement is needed in these proof systems. There's no bound, and we don't want to put a bound. We really want to allow the provers to use as much entanglement as they want, and we don't know how much that is going to be. Yes. There are. So, for example, if you limit them to a polynomial number of qubits, which is sort of reasonable, then you can show that the MIP star is included in NEXP. That's kind of straightforward because you can just, in NEXP, you can guess what is the best strategy. If you limit the size of the strategy, so you bound the amount of entanglement, then you get, so you get upper bounds. I think that's the only thing you know, though. So if you, you know, sort of put a bound on the entanglement, you get a corresponding upper bound on the complexity class. That's a result by Kobayashi, Matsumoto, and I think maybe someone else. So the situation is kind of something like this, right? So we have this class, MIP star. Without the star, we know what it is. But with the star, we don't really know. So it could, there's no upper bound, and it could potentially collapse to something pretty small. I mean, what this is saying is that basically we have these provers, and they're using entanglement to cheat in the proof system, and we're kind of worried. We don't really know how much they'll be able to cheat. So the only thing we can say is that well, worst case is they're no better than just one prover. So let's just, you know, talk about one prover with one prover, ignore the others, in which case we can decide languages in P space. Yeah. Yes, I'll mention that later. It's known that MIP star under some restrictions, you can restrict just to one round, if that was your question. I'll mention it again later. It's also, So making improvements, you know, on both of the question marks is interesting. You know, if you could prove a strong upper bound, something like this, same kind of collapse as we had here, but that would happen in general, that presumably that would lead to an algorithm. That would be the way you would prove such a thing. You'd, you know, for instance, maybe you could from that deduce an algorithm that, say, given a Bell inequality, computes or approximates what is the largest quantum violation that you can get in that Bell inequality, which is something that we don't know how to do currently. And I'm not saying it's direct, but presumably it would be a consequence of such a result. And if you prove that there is no collapse, so if you prove a strong lower bound, then there's no algorithm, so that's sad. But on the other hand, you know, if you prove such a thing, then maybe it means that you've you know, kind of found a technique that prevents the provers from using their entanglement to cheat in your protocol. So it kind of limits the collusion that they get out of that. That maybe can be interesting and useful in some contexts. So this is what we'll do. So our result is that we rule that out, and we show that the second thing is more like what happens in the case of MIP stars. So let me tell you the result. Well, in equations, it's proving a strong lower bound. So it's saying that even if you allow entanglement between the provers, this collapse of MIP does not happen. So MIP star contains NEXP. It contains MIP. It's at least as large as MIP. Maybe rather than reading the theorem, let me just give you a picture of what it's saying. It's saying that if you take any language in NEXP, so this is a very big complexity class, so for example, this, then you can decide that language. A classical polynomial time, you know, BPP verifier can decide that language using a protocol of the following form. So we're going to need five provers. So, okay. We're going to be talking to these five possibly quantum persons through, so there should be many arrows there. It's really a polynomial round interaction. And so it has the properties, completeness and soundness properties that I introduced in the first slide. So if the instance is satisfiable, then there is a way for the provers to convince you with probability one in that case that the instance is satisfiable. And if the instance is not satisfiable, whatever the provers do, even if they use entanglement, so that's kind of the new part of the result, even if they use entanglement, then there's no way they're going to be convinced you with probability larger than a half. And you can make this a half much lower. You can always amplify this by repeating the protocol many times in sequence. So if we look back to the picture that we had before, you know, I was asking this question. So basically what the theorem does is it rules out the first circle. It says this is not going to happen, so there's no collapse there. But then it leaves completely open the question of whether the class could get bigger. This we don't know. You know, could be anywhere in between there. Let me make a few more comments on that result. So that's related to Andy's question. What thing we can do is, if we're not really worried about five provers, six provers, whatever, we can increase the number of provers from five to six, one more, and then we have only one round of interaction. So instead of going back and forth many times, we just go back and forth once. Question, answer, and then we're done. The completeness stays one, and the soundness becomes polynomially close to one. So you lose a little bit in that parameter there. You could improve it if you had a parallel repetition theorem, but there's no parallel repetition theorem for that class. There's implication, hardness of approximation implications for the games. Maybe some of you are familiar with these multiplayer games. But because of the different scaling, like the phrasing is a bit different, so the parameters are not so easy to state. So I don't really want to go into that. In the remaining time, rather, what I want to do is try to give you an idea of how this is proved. And I really want to focus on just like one step in the proof, which I think is the interesting step. Which is interesting, you can follow independently of what I've been saying so far. So the proof is just based on adapting the classical analog, the Babai Fortnow and Lund result, that showed that NXP is included to MIP, so the thing without entanglement. That protocol has two components. One of them is part of the protocol just interacts with one of the provers. It's called the sum check test. It's a technique that was introduced already in the proof that IP is equal to P space, but I'm not going to talk about that. I'm going to focus on the second part, which is something that you play with three provers. So they only had four provers, but we need five for some reason. It's called multilinearity test. So I'm going to explain what this is. And I think this is really this is what we're going to focus on. A sub part of the protocol, I'm not going to tell you how what I'm going to say next implies what is written up there, but it's kind of independent, I think of independent interest. So. So I want to look at that now. So, and actually I'm going to concentrate on even a simpler setting than this multilinearity test, which is the linearity test. So this is a test that was introduced by Bloom, Luby, and Rubinfeld, also in the setting of these interactive proofs. It's really a fundamental idea. It's very useful for the PCP theorem, hardness of approximation. It shows up all over the place. So it's something that's very nice to know if you haven't heard of it before. It is very simple. So what's the setting? We're going to have a protocol with three provers. The questions that we ask these provers, they're going to come from F2 to the N. Because think of that as just being bit strings, right? That's my questions. And answers are just bits. Let me just put the picture up. So, and I'm going to make a simplifying assumption, which is that, so these provers, they each get to see a question in F2 to the N, and they provide an answer in F2. And I'll just assume that they choose their answers in the same way, so according to the same function. All three of them, they play in the same way. I'm just assuming this is the case. And the goal of the test is to check that the function that they're applying is linear. So we want to check that really what they're doing, in general it could be arbitrary, we want to make sure that they're just doing a dot product with some secret string u that they have. So how do we check this? So let me tell you what the test is. It's pretty simple. We're going to send just a random question to the first prover, and he replies, right? Some answer, f of x. Then the second prover, again, we send a random question, and we get a reply. Now the third prover, we're going to send the sum of the two, so sum modulo 2, bit by bit, bitwise sum, of the two questions that were sent to the first two provers. And then again, he replies an answer, right? F of x plus y. And the check that we do, we're trying to check that this function is linear. If it is, then this should be the case, right? So we'll check that the third prover's answer is equal to the sum of the first two provers' answers. If it's the case, then we'll accept them. If it's not the case, then we'll reject. Right, I said that. So I'm assuming they're deterministic, so there's a fixed function that they're applying. And I'm also just, you don't need that assumption in general, but just to simplify, I'm assuming they apply the same function. In general, it's an arbitrary function, and the goal of my test is to make it so that, you know, if they apply a linear function, then they succeed. This is clear. The question is, can they succeed without applying a linear function? Right? And so this is the Bloom, Luby, Rubinfeld result. Their theorem is that it's not the case. So suppose that the provers succeed in this test with probability 1 minus epsilon. So the probability is taken over the choice of random questions, right? I said here x is random, y is random. So that's where the probability comes from. Suppose they succeed with probability close to 1. Then they must be linear in the sense that there must exist some u such that f of x is equal to u dot x for a large fraction of x. So I'm not going to prove this. It's not very hard to prove. One way to prove it is using Fourier analysis. What I want to do is try to discuss what happens to this test in case we give entanglement to the provers. So let's see. We're just playing the same thing. But now these provers are quantum, and maybe they have a quantum state. Just playing the same game, right? And I'd like to arrive at the same conclusion. So if we just model the situation, now they're not applying a function. I'm again going to make a symmetry assumption, which is that they apply the same measurement. So they have this quantum state. They receive their question x. And based on x, each of them measures their share of psi using a binary measurement. And it produces an outcome, 0 or 1. And this is what they send back as their answer. OK, and now the question is, you know, what are we trying to show exactly? Before, we had a fixed function, and it made sense to ask the question, well, you know, what does it mean for that function to be linear? Here, what does it mean for these measurements? These are big matrices. What does it mean for the entangled provers to be linear? That's actually the main hurdle you sort of have to face when you're trying to do this analysis in the quantum setting, is understand what you're talking about. So for instance, one thing to keep in mind, one thing that these entangled provers can do, which is very simple, is say they use a GHZ state, and they just measure the GHZ state in the computational basis. So what's going to happen, they're going to get a random outcome. Each of them will get the same outcome. And depending on that outcome, they decide to apply the same linear function to their inputs. So if they do that, because they always apply the same linear function, they're going to pass my test. But I can't say, as I was saying in the BLR theorem, that there is some linear function such that the provers always answer according to that linear function. It's not true. They're using their shared randomness in order to pick a random function. If I look only at the answers of the first prover, for instance, these just look completely random. I can't make this kind of statement. So we have to change, if we hope to generalize this to the quantum setting, we definitely have to change the statement. In order to accommodate the example I just gave you, here's one way we could change the statement. Instead of saying that there exists a linear function, we could say, well, there exists a distribution on linear functions such that the provers basically behave the same as provers who would, well, first do exactly what I said, choose a random linear function from this joint distribution. So they each pick a linear function, but the same linear function, and then answer their question according to that linear function. But if the provers do that, then they'll succeed in my test. And morally, this is basically the same as what we had before. It's just something that we can't really avoid. And we have to accommodate it, so at least we have to allow for this kind of lemma. But now that I've phrased it in this way, maybe it's kind of clear what the quantum analogue of the lemma should be, right? We're almost there. Just a few more modifications. Instead of saying that the provers have a distribution on linear functions, what we could say is they have a measurement. So these provers has a measurement. It doesn't depend on any question or anything. It's a fixed universal, it's a fixed measurement. The measurement has outcomes among the linear functions such that the original provers, so any provers who applied arbitrary A but were successful in that test, are, so there's a little bit of a loss of parameters, root epsilon, and you have a, did you have no? Right, yeah. It's not. Yeah, I was going to elaborate more on that, but sort of philosophically, you're proving something a little bit different. But in the end, you're right. Yeah. Indistinguishable. Okay. Okay, so I've changed the lemma. So this is the lemma that that we can prove in the quantum setting, and it's saying that if you succeed in this test, then the provers are basically indistinguishable from provers who would first make a measurement. This measurement has outcome the name of a linear function. They're going to, I didn't write it, but it's the case that they're each going to get the same linear function with high probability. And then once they get their question, they apply the linear function that they got as the outcome of the measurement. So this is something we can prove. So one comment is that this measurement that I'm putting, the important point is that it doesn't depend on the input. And because it doesn't depend on the question, it's a measurement you could make even before the game starts. You can just do it right away. So why don't, and that's the sense in which we can say that this linearity test is resistant to provers who use entanglement, because morally we've, or practically, effectively, we've reduced them to being classical, because they can make this measurement before the game starts, and then they just play a classical strategy. Another point is, okay, what is this indistinguishable thing? And this is kind of important, because if you want to be able to use this, you need a sort of a proper notion of indistinguishable. What I really want to say is if I replace the provers I had originally, arbitrary provers that were successful with high probability, by the provers that have this form, then the verifier can't tell the difference. But we want something strong enough that a little bit stronger than that, in the sense that, you know, if you remember my overall goal, this is just a small piece in a big protocol that maybe has, you know, more provers than three, and it has more tests and things like that. And we want to be able to say that, you know, if we do the analysis of this test as a sub-part of the protocol, we can actually replace the provers in that sub-part of the protocol by these query-independent provers, and still the overall behavior of the protocol will not be changed from the point of view of the verifier. So we want a notion that's strong enough for that, and then we have such a notion. And just to point out, you know, that you can't hope for too much either in terms of indistinguishable. For instance, I can't really hope to make any statements about the operators themselves. I can't say that the measurement is close to, because I never have access to this measurement, right? It's as a verifier, I only get to see the answers, the outputs of the measurement. So I can't really say what the matrix is itself. Okay, so that's the statement. So let me just, I'm not going to prove it, but I want to give you an idea just so that it doesn't look too much, you know, taken out of my hat. What is this measurement, how you define it, because it's actually not too hard to define. If we think back about the classical setting, right, let's just go back to classical deterministic provers for a second. So these provers just applied a function, and we know, you know, this is just Fourier analysis over F2 to the n. We can expand this function in its Fourier basis. So these are the Fourier coefficients, they're real numbers, and these are the Fourier basis, so linear functions. And what my lemma is trying to say is that any function that the provers, that the provers apply, is close to a distribution over linear functions. And we're almost there, right? That's a distribution over linear functions. The reason is that this function here is a linear function, and that, the modulus, or the absolute value squared of the Fourier coefficients, they're non-negative, and they sum to 1 because this was a Boolean function. That's Parseval's formula. So this is a function of the form that we want, and this is the function that we actually have. And one interpretation of the BLR linearity test is in saying that if the function passes the linearity test, then these two are close. So now we can do exactly the same thing for the quantum provers. In general, instead of applying a function, they were applying observables, so, you know, big matrices, Hermitian matrices that square to 1. But we can define a matrix-valued Fourier coefficient of the observables. So it's just defined here. It's exactly the same thing, except A of x is the observable that the prover applies on the query x. And now I can square this matrix, it's Hermitian. I'm going to get something that's positive, so at least that's a positive operator in the positive semi-definite sense. And you have an analog of Parseval's formula that applies to these matrices. So just by not assuming anything, this is a POVM. They're positive and they sum to identity, so it's a measurement. And the content here is in saying that, well, if I am to apply that measurement before the test starts, and then answer u dot x, then this strategy is going to be close to whatever the original strategy was, provided that original strategy had a high success probability in the linearity test. So last thing I want to say is a little bit what's the difference with the actual thing that we need for the NXP proof system, which is not the linearity test, it's the multilinearity test, which is a generalization of the linearity test. So in that case, we're testing a slightly different property, actually. So now we're looking at a function, fm. So think of m as being large, not necessarily prime, but pretty large, like polynomial in n. There's n variables, and the variables are taken in this large finite field. So for example, a linear function when n is equal to 2 is something that looks like this, right? So it's a bilinear function, meaning that it's linear in each of its variables. So this is the property that we really want to test. Is the function that the provers apply multilinear in that sense, linear of each of its variables? And the test that was introduced by Babai, Fortnow and Lund, is it's very simple. You're just going to test linearity in each of the n possible directions. So you'll first pick index for a variable, I in n, and then you'll randomly fix all the other coordinates, and then you'll check linearity in that one direction. I don't know if I, yeah, sorry, I didn't put the picture up. So you're fixing all but one variable. You're fixing all but one variable and testing linearity in the direction of the variable that you haven't fixed yet. And the way they analyze it is by induction. So they're going to progressively eliminate, let me explain how the induction goes in the bilinear case. So what they'll do is they'll first say, well, let's just fix the second variable to anything, some arbitrary fixed thing. And now my test says that, you know, along the direction of this first x variable, the function should be linear. So they have some analysis which says that if this is the case, then actually for any fixed y, you can say that this function of x should be close to a linear function of x, which depends on y. So for every possible value of y, you recover this linear equation. And then what you really want to recover is a bilinear function defined over the whole xy plane. And this you do by interpolation. So you have you take two possible different values of y. So y1 and y2, and you have these two line equations here and here. And you'll interpolate between the equation of this line and the equation of this line to get a bilinear equation over the whole plane. And they show that this gives a good approximation to the original function f, provided it succeeded in the test that I described above. So there's one tricky thing about this procedure is that the error that you have, like the quality of these approximations, blows up as you go through. So first you find linear approximations, then bilinear, then you'll continue trilinear, et cetera, until you've gone all the way to linear in all the variables. But at every step in the induction, the error blows up by too much than you can afford. Say it doubles. Every time you do this, it doubles. A number of steps is n, so you'll get an exponential blow up in your error. And they have to find a way to deal with that. So it's called self-correction. They have a lemma that says that, well, actually, you know, even though it seems the error blows up, it actually doesn't. And this is a step I just wanted to say, if anyone is interested, this is the step that's harder to do in the case of entangled provers, this correction procedure. In their case, they're able to show that they have a theorem that says, well, you know, you thought the error was big, but actually it's not that big. In our case, this is not true. The error does go up, and you have to do self-correction. You have to modify a little bit the objects that you're constructing through the induction. But in the end, you manage to prove a theorem which is very similar to the one that we had for the linearity test, except the parameters are a little bit worse. Right, so suppose provers succeeded with high probability in the multilinearity test. Now there exists, again, a measurement that's input independent. It doesn't have outcomes in linear functions. It has outcomes in all possible multilinear functions. So it's a measurement that has a huge number of outcomes. It produces the name of a multilinear function. And then the provers are roughly indistinguishable from ones that would, you know, make this measurement, get the multilinear function. And then when later their question arrives, they apply the function that they had obtained to the question that they receive. And oh, yeah, yeah, 1 over epsilon times n, sorry. It's epsilon. Yeah, it's epsilon times n. I mean, so what I should have written is that if epsilon is less than, you know, 1 over n to the 100 or something, then you get... Yeah, yeah, okay, yeah, thanks. And that's the main component. Once you have that, you can go back to the Babai Fortnow and Lund protocol that had also this sum check test and other components. You can plug this in and, you know, make sure that things work out, and luckily they do. So I'll just finish here with a few questions. I think there's a lot of questions. I mean, this is why I try to start a little bit slowly. There's few things we know about these complexity classes, and there, yeah. Yes, and it's actually crucial that M is large. So I guess there's this poly again. So, but we need M to be much larger than N, at least, I'm not sure, but some power of N. In what sense? You mean in the way this is written, or?
Should we think that polynomial is an epsilon times?
Yeah. I'm sorry. Yeah. You shouldn't, yeah, I'm sorry. So this is the first time I show this slide, and it's terrible, so I'm sorry. It should really read for any n, for any m that's much larger than n, for any epsilon that's much smaller than 1 over n, or 1 over n to the 10. And then here you'd get epsilon to the 1 over 100, and then you'd get, Sorry about that. Okay, just a few questions. One interesting question is that we don't know what's the relevance of the number of provers in these protocols. So I think I forgot to mention this, but in the case where they're classical provers, in the classical setting, we know that two provers are just as good as more than two. We also know that one round of interaction is just as good as more rounds of interaction. So it doesn't help. As long as you have one round of interaction with two provers, it doesn't help to have more provers or more rounds. In a quantum setting, we don't know. And for instance, our result uses five provers. We think maybe we can get four, which is what Babai, Fortnow, and Lund get. But really, I don't know. So interesting question is whether you can get fewer, and more interesting question is you know, whether it makes a difference. Is there a qualitative difference between having two, three, four, five provers? And there's this, you know, settings that are slightly different from this one where it does make a difference. Here we don't really know. Of course, there's the question of improving parameters. So we have this protocol that has, you know, polynomial number of rounds of interaction, and it gets very large answer size, polynomial length answers from the provers. Can you improve all of these parameters? In the same way as this was done after the MIP equals NX result was proven, people started working on these parameters, scaling things down, and this is what eventually led to the PCP theorem. So, you know, maybe it's interesting to try to investigate similar things in the case where there's entanglement. It would also, you know, if you're interested in proving hardness results for Bell inequalities, right? This question of given a Bell inequality, how hard is it to compute or approximate the maximum success probability of quantum provers? The maximum violation using quantum mechanics of the Bell inequality. And we kind of want to show that this problem is NP-hard. And our results don't imply that it's NP-hard. It implies something slightly weaker. It implies that it's hard. It's not, you can't do it in BPP, but not as much as NP-hard because of the fact that the parameters here are not so good. So if you improve this, you could get hardness for the question of Bell inequalities. And I think this linearity, multilinearity test analysis that we give should be of interest in various settings where you're trying to limit the power that provers can use from their entanglement, maybe cryptographic settings, for instance. Of course, there's this big open question of proving upper bounds, so that's a nice, completely open question. Just end with financial sources. Okay, that's whatever, but more important is I got a lot of support from Umesh. I want to credit him. Umesh is the first person who suggested to look at the Babai Fortnow Lund protocol. It was a very useful suggestion, so I should credit him appropriately. Of course, my co-author Tsuyoshi and the audience. Thank you.